Penguin Random House Audio presents Hunter Killer, Inside America's Unmanned Air War, by Lieutenant Colonel T. Mark Mccurley, with Kevin Maurer. Read for you by Holter Graham. Author's note. I am an operator. I am not a door kicker. I do not fast rope, rappel, or jump out of airplanes. Never have I been called upon to assault any position, be it fixed or fluid, though I have been trained to do so. I do not claim to be like the SEALs or Special Forces. That wasn't my career path. But I am still an operator, a fighter. In 2003, more than a decade into my Air Force career, I faced a third consecutive assignment to a non-combat unit. I volunteered for the only combat job available to me at the time, the RQ-1 Predator. Dog, my squadron commander, looked sidelong at me when I made my request. A crusty, old-school fighter pilot, he shared the same belief as the rest of the Air Force, and even myself. Predators were for chumps.
Mark, are you sure you want this?
He asked. Dog deeply cared about his people and would cheerfully work any assignment for me if I truly desired it.
This won't be good for your career.
Careerism had never been my goal. I had long ago elected to deviate from the normal expected path and bounce from aircraft to aircraft with each assignment. The Air Force expected officers to stick with one aircraft their whole careers. Each community told me the same thing. A change would be bad for my promotion opportunities. Sir, I said, I just want to get into the fight. Do my part. I had felt that way since September 11th. I had been leading a T-6A formation sortie over Valdosta, Georgia, when the Federal Aviation Administration directed us to land. The controller was both curt and professional, but it was unusual, since military often were exempted from such directives. After we landed, our engines had barely spun to a stop before the excited crew chief ran up to us, asking if we'd heard the news. Someone had flown an airplane into the World Trade Center. At first, we had reacted skeptically. After all, inexperienced pilots flew their little aircraft perilously close to the towers all the time. Sightseers did stupid things like that. But when I'd gotten to the 3rd Flying Training Squadron duty desk, I joined 24 instructor pilots and students, huddled around the screen, watching clips of an airliner barreling into the first tower. The video repeated and repeated. And then it changed. It was subtle at first, then nightmarishly clear. The live icon flashed as the airliner plunged again into the tower. Another aircraft thundered into the second tower. We all knew one hit was an accident. Two was intentional. We were in a war unlike any other fought by the United States. And I wanted to do my part. Dog sighed.
All right, I'll work this for you.
Thank you, sir. Hunter Killer is the story of an extraordinary group of young men and women with whom I had the honor to serve from 2003 through 2012. It is also the story of the Predator and its evolution from an aviation backwater joke to the tip of the spear in the war against terrorism. In this book, I use only tactical call signs, nicknames, or first names to protect the identities of the pilots and crew. Certain senior leaders whose identities are already in the public domain are mentioned by name. Radio call signs for aircraft, units, or persons have been documented as accurately as my memory can manage. Some tactical call signs have been modified to ensure security of those entities still in harm's way. I've taken great pains not to include details of any ongoing missions. I have also endeavored to protect specific tactics and procedures currently used by our crews as they continue to fight. Hunter Killer is written from my point of view. This is a ground-level perspective of life in the remotely piloted aircraft community. I have strived to accurately portray events as they occurred, but the fog of war may have clouded how I perceived actions or remembered details. Any errors in the text are mine. Additionally, any opinions articulated here are also my own and do not represent the views of the United States Air Force, Department of Defense, or United States government. This story was written to honor the small cadre of aviators, the operators, who fought and continue to fight a war deep in the shadows. Hunter Killer is their story. We have just won a war with a lot of heroes flying around in planes. The next war may be fought by airplanes with no men in them at all. Take everything you've learned about aviation and war, throw it out of the window, and let's go to work on tomorrow's aviation. It will be different from anything the world has ever seen. General Henry Hap Arnold, U.S. Army Air Forces, VJ Day, 1945. Prologue, Retribution. The phone rang in the Squadron Operations Center, and I snatched it after the first ring. It was my private line, direct to the Joint Task Force, based at Camp Limonier in Djibouti. We'd been tracking a high-profile target, and I had a feeling this was the call we'd been waiting for weeks. "Squirrel here," I said. On the line was the Predator Liaison Officer, or LNO. He worked for the Joint Operations Center, JOC, commander. His job was to coordinate Predator missions in the region. My squadron provided the Predators to keep watch and strike suspected terrorists and pirates. "Launch," the liaison officer said. "How many?" "All three," he said. Three Predators, equipped with two AGM 114 Hellfire missiles, each waited on the ramp. The planes were in alert status, ready to take off at a moment's notice. The phone line wasn't secure enough to confirm it, but I knew one thing as I hung up the phone. Today, the wolf pack hunted. It was September 30th, 2011. I was the commander of the 60th Expeditionary Reconnaissance Squadron at Camp Limonier, which was built by the French Foreign Legion in Djibouti. The country was a former French colony with oppressively hot weather and few assets, save its location northwest of Somalia and across the Gulf of Aden from Yemen. It was prime strategic real estate for American counter-terror operations. Camp Limonier shares the single runway at Djibouti Ambouli International Airport, on the outskirts of Djibouti City, and close to the only major seaport servicing East Africa. Following the September 11th attacks, the United States leased it from the Djiboutian government for $38 million a year in order to establish a conduit for its humanitarian operations in the interior. The Marines were the first Americans at the base in 2002 and quickly established a small base capable of airlift operations. The mission of the Combined Joint Task Force Horn of Africa quickly grew to include intelligence gathering operations throughout East Africa. A few years later, the JOC stood up to address the growing terrorism threat in the region and across the Gulf of Aden in the Arabian Peninsula. I hung up the phone and gave the order to launch. My director of operations called the maintainers on the ramp and passed the word. The single props on the backs of the Predators started to hum as the pilots in the ground control station, a shipping container with cockpits containing everything needed to control the aircraft, started pre-flight checks. My pilots slowly maneuvered the Predators off the ramp and onto the runway. Three crews 8,000 miles away in the United States scrambled to their cockpits, sitting at consoles in air-conditioned quarters at Cannon Air Force Base in New Mexico, waiting to take control of the birds. My pilots in Djibouti would perform the takeoff and turn over control of the Predators to pilots in the United States to fly the mission. As a 10-year veteran of the Predator program, I'd been on that end of these missions countless times before. No other aircraft in the Air Force used two crews, one to take off and the other to fly the mission. It wasn't the only way our program was unique. I went outside to watch the launch. The thermometer near the building hovered at 95 degrees as the three aircraft started to spin up. Heat was a worse enemy to the Predators than Al-Qaeda. The heat window was upon us. If it got any hotter, the delicate electronics within the predators could overheat and melt before reaching the cooler temperatures at higher altitudes. Back in the operations center, I could hear over the radio as the Djiboutian air traffic control tower cleared the predators to take off. I watched from a concrete barrier as the predators lumbered down the runway, barely able to lift off, if not for the slight incline at the end of the tunnel.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.